I think we can get started. If everyone would curb your enthusiasm just slightly. It's an exciting topic for this evening's conversation. I'm Jonathan Brent. I'm executive director of the YIVO Institute. And it's really a pleasure not only to welcome you all here this evening for this topic, but it's an immense pleasure to be, in a way, welcoming this topic to YIVO. No one 25 years ago, I think, aside from a few visionaries, would have thought that a subject like tonight's conversation was even possible. I think many of us grew up, whether it was in a Polish home, a Jewish home, or a Polish-Jewish home, or a Jewish-Polish home, thinking that the lines of separation were insurmountable, insurmountably deep, and insurmountably wide, that the history had been broken, and that it could not really be repaired. And what is beautiful today is that we are living in a time of reparation, largely brought about by the passage of time, by the demise of the Soviet Union, by the collapse of the last real totalitarian empire of Europe, the basis of which was the erasure of memory. And so it has given us an opportunity to regain some of our human impulses, which tonight I think all of us in one way or another will be honoring. I want to thank and acknowledge our co-sponsors for this evening, the Polish Cultural Institute, with whom we have developed very warm, cordial, and fruitful relations over these last couple of years, and Tablet Magazine, of course, which is a wonderful journal. If any of you don't know it, you should certainly go online and find it, Journal of Contemporary Jewish Life Globally. That said, I want to say that YIVO, partly because of the awakening of the awakening in Eastern Europe and the awakening of our consciousness here in America of Eastern Europe and the power and the importance of that history for American Jewry, we have reclaimed our place as a global institution as well, not only through our websites and our various activities, but through our alliance with this extraordinary museum in Poland that just celebrated its opening, Poline. And with us this evening is one person in particular in the YIVO community who has had more to do with that museum and with stimulating our ability to make these connections across the oceans and frankly across time and across consciousness. And that's Irene Pletka, who is sitting with us this evening. Irene. But it's also the great enthusiasm of Jews living in Poland or who have come to Poland from America or elsewhere who have responded also to this desire to reawaken and give a new life and a new beginning. And I want to acknowledge Jonathan Ornstein, who's director of the JCC in Krakow, who has, I think everybody knows, done unbelievable things in this respect. So I'm glad both of you are here with us this evening. Thank you for coming. If you are pleased with tonight's program, if you are interested in the directions that the YIVO Institution is taking, not simply for the preservation of documents and archives that are a record of the past, but for making a connection between those documents and archives that we have in boxes up on the 11th and 10th floors of this building and in Newark, the connection, the most important thing we are doing is making a connection between that material and ourselves and people and places and a living reality and a future for the Jewish people. We have just, we are going to show an interview by Yitzhak Arad at our dinner on December 17th. And he says one thing in it that is at the core of this institution, the core of the ethos of this institution, which is without a past, the Jewish people can have no future. And the YIVO Institute is intent on reclaiming that past in Eastern Europe through knowledge, through historical research, through going to Poland, going to Lithuania, going to Ukraine, going to Russia, and seeing and re-experiencing, and then also coming back to our own reality and making it and integrating it into ourselves. It's a task which we are setting about with great enthusiasm and optimism, and I think now is the time to embrace it. And if you are with us on that, and if this is something that is interesting to you, I invite you to become a member of the YIVO Institute today. And there are forms out there on those tables, and there are people here in the hall who can help you become members at whatever level you may be interested, which will give you access to all of our materials and help you understand your way through all of the programs that we have. One lady said to me tonight, this is the third time this week she has been here. And that is itself indicative of the intense new activity that we are sponsoring. I wish now to introduce the panelists for our program. Samuel Kassow is our moderator. Charles H. Northam, Professor of History at Trinity College, well known to everyone in this room for his tremendously erudite and important works on the Ringelblum Archive, his knowledge of Eastern Europe, the history of Polish Jews. The history of Jews in Eastern Europe is encyclopedic in breadth and astounding in its depth. His 2007 book, Who Will Write Our History? Emmanuel Ringelblum, the Warsaw Ghetto and Oinig Shabbos Archive, was published by Indiana University Press. He is a fellow of the American Academy for Jewish Research and the recipient of numerous awards. Konstanty Gebert is an international reporter, columnist for Polish and international media, and associate fellow for the European Council on Foreign Relations. He was a Democratic opposition activist in the 1970s and an underground journalist in the 1980s. Gebert was co-founder of the Underground Jewish Flying University in Poland, which to me here in the United States was really quite a legendary thing, as I'm sure it was to many of you. I heard about this from all of my Polish friends constantly. In Poland and the Polish Council of Christians and Jews, and the founder of the Polish Jewish Intellectual Monthly Midrash. He is the author of 11 books. Piotr Paziński is a novelist, essayist, translator, editor-in-chief of Midrash. He has written two books on Ulysses and in 2009 published his novella, The Boarding House, which was shortlisted for the Nike Award and received the cultural award of the Polish weekly Polityka for literature, film, theater, music, and the visual arts in 2009, as well as the European Union Prize for Literature in 2012. In 2013, Paziński published his second volume, Birds, Streets, a collection of three short stories and one novella on Jewish collective memory overshadowed by the Holocaust. Katka Reszke is a filmmaker, writer, and researcher of Jewish history, culture, and identity. As a writer and documentary filmmaker, she specializes in Polish Jewish history and relations, as well as human rights, social justice, minority, and gender issues. In Poland, Reszke worked at the Museum of the History of Polish Jews, now Polin, and at the Jewish Agency for Israel. She is currently working on a theater project called We Keep Coming Back about Polish-Jewish identity. Geneviève Zubrzycki, which I was told was not obligatory on my part to pronounce it that way, is associate, because she was born in Quebec, is associate professor of sociology, faculty associate at the Frankel Center for Judaic Studies and director of the Center for Russian, East European, and Eurasian Studies at University of Michigan. Her book, The Crosses of Auschwitz, Nationalism and Religion in Post-Communist Poland, University of Chicago Press, received several awards in the US and recently appeared in Polish. Zubrzycki is now at work on a new book on the current revival of Jewish communities in Poland and non-Jewish Poles' interest in all things Jewish. We will begin the program this evening, however, with a short 5-6 minute film clip made by Katka Reszke as part of her ongoing project to document the lives and issues facing Jews living in Poland today. Following this clip, we will invite the panelists up here to join us for the conversation. Thank you.
Zrozumiał, że wszyscy są Well, good evening.
Welcome,
everybody. I was very fascinated by this film, and that leads me to raise a first question, which I'll address to Geneviève, then you could all take it up, which is, what accounts for this interest in the culture festivals, in Jewish life that you see in Poland? I remember that when I was in Warsaw in 2013 for the 70th anniversary of the ghetto uprising and for the soft opening of the museum, there were kids all over the city handing out little yellow pins saying, remember. There were young people trying to form a human chain along the former wall of the ghetto. Now, I know that we hear quite a lot about the swastikas and about the chants at football games. We hear a lot less about this. And so I'd like you to perhaps explain why you think, what you think lies behind this interest in these culture festivals and so on.
Is this plugged in? Yes, okay. First, what I want to say about those festivals, they've existed for a long time. The first one, it was created, the Krakow Festival, 1988. There was already, and Kostek can talk about this, a revival of Jewish life under communism. Well, the first festival of Jewish culture in Krakow was founded in 1988. The first one I attended was in 1990, and basically it was 2 days and very few people and very little things to see, very few people going. It really took off about 10 to 15 years ago. 1995, 2000 is when it became a mass movement, and that you see in festivals, but in all sorts of spheres of Polish life. I link this to a broader phenomenon that's related to redefining Polish national identity. That's a phenomenon that's been very important in politics and culture since the fall of communism. That has to do also with a re-examination of what Polishness is about and its link with Catholicism, and a rediscovery of quote-unquote others. And with that, you have this parallel movement of Jews also reconnecting with their Jewish identity. Movements within the Catholic Church also opening toward Judaism. The Pope John Paul II was important in kind of creating this. So there's several places where this impetus is coming from, and that coalesces, and that's really, perhaps you could say, is culminating now with the opening of the Museum of the History of Polish Jews. So it's a phenomenon that has several strands, and the most visible one for non-Poles are the festivals. And it's often portrayed less so now, but as a Disneylandish kind of kitschy thing, but actually it's a very meaningful way to experience Jewish culture for non-Jews, and also for Jews like the Jews that Katka is researching, people who are just discovering their own Jewish roots, to go and get in touch with Jewish culture from a very safe, neutral space. And institutions like the JCC in Krakow and now in Warsaw are also providing that space for Jews and non-Jews to encounter Jewishness, different facets of Jewishness on an everyday life basis, not just at festivals.
If I may add, you know, the thing with the Krakow Cultural Festival and with other festivals is that they really began mostly as enterprises that came into being by non-Jews for non-Jews. And over the past, you know, a few decades, really, that has changed tremendously. Today, the Krakow Jewish Culture Festival and other festivals are largely created by Jews and non-Jews together for Jews and non-Jews, both in Poland and those who come for the festival from abroad. And that makes a huge difference. And you know, the museum is actually an example also of that sort of larger movement in terms of actually creating a new Polish Jewish culture in contemporary Poland today by Jews and non-Jews together as a sort of shared responsibility. It's a very fascinating process to observe over the course of the last few decades how things have changed. The festival in Krakow was a completely different thing 20 years ago than it is today. And you know, the GCC actually in Krakow, which very much also endorses the cooperation between Jews and non-Jews, is now a major venue for the festival. Almost half of the festival happens at the GCC. And I would say the most interesting things happen at the GCC.
But what explains that shift towards the greater role of the greater degree of cooperation, the greater role of Jews as well as Poles in these festivals?
Well, I think that there's also part of curiosity that stems also with the realization and the encounter with the history of the Holocaust as well. So in a lot of my interviews, for example, with JCC volunteers, so there's a lot of non-Jews who volunteer 10, 20 hours a week, who do it for all sorts of reasons at the beginning and then continue volunteering for years on. When you talk about them, with them about why they started or how they became interested in Jews and Poland, Jewishness, etc., a lot of them refer to Jedwabne and hearing about the pogrom and that shock they had in learning about this, the realization that they were not taught about the history of World War II, that the Jews were not really mentioned, the role of Poles in the Holocaust was not really discussed, and at the basis. This becomes the basis for being curious about who Jews were, what happened to them, where are they now, etc. And there's also a lot of commemorations that the Polish state has been involved with the liberation of Auschwitz. Every 5 years, there are commemorations where there's more talk about this, the whole debate about Jedwabne and books about Gross, and people coming out. I mean, you're talking about coming out of the closet. And that becomes important. People become curious.
And the question is how much, you know, the sort of general atmosphere of festivals and the so-called revival actually aids to people who are considering coming out, who people who now discover they have Jewish roots. I mean, it's an important question to ask. What's the likelihood of you embracing your Jewish roots at a time when it's sort of hip to be Jewish in Poland, or where there's an interest in Jewish culture in Poland, or where you actually happen to have six other friends who like Jewish culture and go to Jewish culture festivals, and then you discover Jewish roots. So it's obviously it's a question of how much interdependence there is between the two phenomena. And you know, of course, it's very much poignant in this generation and in the third generation. And even, and especially really for younger people, people are in their 20s today, people in their early 30s who are discovering Jewish roots in Poland, the fact that there is a Jewish culture festival and a Jewish studies department in almost every large university in Poland right now actually does make a difference today in how you're going to react to discovering Jewish roots today. But then, of course, there are people like Piotr and like Kostek who've known for much longer than the revival has been happening, and so it's, you know, there are different narratives.
Kostek, Piotr, do you have anything to add about this whole idea of Polish interest in Jewish culture?
Well, certainly, but first of all, we need to put it in context. The topic of today's panel, reviving Jewish life in Poland, is old news. I mean, the reviving happened 25 years ago, okay? There is a Jewish community. There are 27 different organizations, religious and secular, mainly don't speak to each other, which is a kind of standard feature. There is Jewish life in Poland. It's not terribly interesting. It's a very small community. Card-carrying members of different Jewish organizations nationwide combined are 8,000. Another 15,000 may be identified but don't affiliate, the Groucho Marxists, right? But this, what we're talking about, the museum, the festivals, this isn't the Jewish revival, it's a Polish revival. individual Jews participate in it much more than they did 20 years ago, mainly because there are much more Jews to participate. The organized Jewish community doesn't. The Krakow Jewish Festival is a wonderful thing, and I've been at this first festival that just reminded us of. But the problem is then, the final concert Saturday night on Szeroka Street means we can't daven in the Remushul, right? We can't daven in the temple because it's being used. I mean, okay, there are other places, but mainly what happens is this festival displaces normal, organized Jewish life. I'm not kvetching, I'm just simply stating a fact. The same is true of the museum. It's the core exhibition was designed by Jewish scholars. Now it's been taken over by the museum, which is a Polish state institution, and rightly so. But this isn't Jewish life. And so the most interesting, most spectacular things that are happening in Poland, and which truly were difficult to imagine a quarter century ago, are not part of the Jewish revival. They're part of a general revival of Polish culture and Polish identity. I agree with you. And one element of that is reconnecting with the past, where Poland had been until 45, always pluri-ethnic, plurinational, multicultural. It wasn't fun. It wasn't the kind of joyful mutual embrace that we see today. Definitely not, but it was there, and Poland is simply incomprehensible to Poles once they're only left with themselves. And there's also this phenomenon that often quoted of phantom pains, right? You amputate a limb, but it still hurts. And in a way, this is very good news, because what it means is that you can't have a genocide and business as usual. That three generations later, there's still something wrong. There's a great book on the image of the Jew in Polish peasant culture by Alina Cała. It's translated to English, published like 2 decades ago. Alina did her research in the 70s when there were still a lot of peasants who remembered Jews as they were, and she collected their remembrance of the Jews. It was, of course, full of ritual murder and venerating the devil in their synagogues and whatever, and one of the her interlocutors, after giving all those things, he said, but you know what? Ever since they're gone, the harvests aren't right. And what you've been describing is an attempt to have better harvests.
I have two things to what Kostek just said, when I agree with him, and the other I disagree. I agree that it's a phantom pain, and I think it's one more important factor. This is rediscovering the sense of void and the sense of loss. For many decades, you know, at Poles, they knew that the Jews were having annihilated by the having a sense of loss and having a sense of void. So now it's been rediscovered, and it's like Freudian process of reworking one's own past and one's own memory, and so people start thinking, what does it mean to me? I live in a very small town, and what does it mean to me? My town was 80% Jewish before the war. Doesn't mean anything to me or to my family history, to my place or not. So I think it's people will start asking and start digging in the past and start trying to grasp it, to understand what it means to them that the world of their forefathers that was Jewish world in a way. So that's one thing. And the other, I disagree with the Jewish studies. I think the Jewish studies, because the Jewish community in Poland is very tidy and organized Jewish life is very small. So I think that in some way, the Jewish studies and people involved in the Jewish studies become part of a Jewish community either, you know, just even non-Jews, they become in a way a part of the community because they do care, because they're interested, because they learn and they teach. If you rely on Jews only, you know, you have no Jewish studies in Poland. It's like everywhere. I give an example, maybe, you know, that illustrates this way of rediscovering the Jewish heritage by non-Jews. It's like, you know, since my early years, I've been a, you know, great fan of rhythm blues and blues music. And I always learned that, you know, it has been rediscovered by the white British musicians that came to America and they found Muddy Waters, they found, you know, Howlin' Wolf and this Afro-American heritage that was done in Mississippi Delta and then in Chicago, then came and they rediscovered this musician and helped them, you know, to find their way to the general white public. So this is, I think this is the same with the, of course, this analogy, this world, the Afro-American world hasn't been annihilated like Jewish world in Europe. But I think it works partly as an analogy of rediscovering but helping. So I think, it's a part of Jewish community, Jewish studies. And I think it's even more important to, you know, to have it in Poland.
One development in Poland, which many Jews outside of Poland are not aware of, is this phenomenal development of Jewish studies. The very strong academic departments in Wrocław, Marcin Wojcinski in Lublin, with Monika Garbowska Adamczyk, with in Krakow, issuing of journals such as Kvartalnik Historii Żydów, Zwischen, which is entirely devoted to Yiddish culture, Midrash, which is a terrific journal, I think one of the best Jewish periodicals that are now being published, and I'm wondering what you think the future is for Jewish studies in Poland. Right now, it seems to be getting stronger and stronger. History, literature, anthropology. Is this something that you think is going to last?
I do hope so, yeah.
I think that the problem is that this stuff is being published in two not terribly popular Jewish languages, Polish and Yiddish. So it simply doesn't circulate in the general Jewish world. But there is an impressive growth of Jewish studies amongst young non-Jewish Polish scholars who are discovering a treasure trove of Jewish language sources for the history of Poland. This promotes the knowledge of Jewish studies, but also deepens an understanding of Poland, and also politically a very different understanding from the understanding of Poland resuming itself to ethnic Poland. So while the great masters of Polish Jewish history still reside abroad, the scholarly youth, as it were, more and more comes from Poland, so I think that within a generation we will see Polish Jewish history returning to Poland and retaking root there. At any course of Yiddish and Hebrew, the overwhelming majority will be non-Jewish young academics desperate to learn the tools of their trade. And I remember years ago at a conference in Jerusalem, a young Polish academic was describing Literatur Bleter, which was a highbrow Jewish weekly in interwar Poland, and she was quoting from it, first in Yiddish and then giving her own translation into English. And I was sitting next to Yehuda Bauer, who turns to me and says, "She speaks it the way it was spoken when it was spoken."
I think that, if I may, one thing that's really important is the political salience, actually, of that movement. And the re-narrativization of Polish history as a formerly pluralistic nation. And I think that this is really part of what's going on as well. that people are, since 1989, there's been a great effort to redefine Polish national identity along different lines than the ethno-Catholic. And I think that the left had certain difficulty using a civic language of citizens because the communists on the one hand had used this language, so had perverted it or delegitimized it on the one hand, and on the other, it was a language from the West. It was, you know, that's the French and the American model. We're different here. I think that going back to pre-World War II Poland and really emphasizing the Jewish roots and the Jewish history in Poland is allowing people on the left to re-narrate Polish history as pluri and multicultural. It's a way to think of itself, for Poles to think of themselves as part of a modern world system, basically, even though most of the population, the overwhelming population is, you know, 95% nominally Catholic and ethnically Polish. To me, the interesting thing is why the focus on Jews instead, for example, of the Vietnamese, which constitute the largest visible minority in Warsaw, for example, or other ethnic minorities. So that's a question that's important. Why do Poles rebuild or reimagine Poland as a multicultural nation? And the emphasis is primarily on Jews and much less on the Ukrainians, Lithuanians, Belarusians, Lemkos, or Kashubs, or Vietnamese, for example.
Well, I think it's very simple. Reintegrating into the Polish collective image of Polishness, the Ukrainians, Belarusians, and Lithuanians is not going to be welcomed by the Lithuanians, Belarusians, and Lithuanians, who are sick and tired of being told that they're almost Polish and they could really qualify. So it's not a very popular thing. On the other hand, including the Vietnamese, or heaven forbid, the Roma, would offend the fundamental racism, which is still very much present in Poland, whereas Jews by now pass as honorary whites anyway. And reintegrating them into a Polish collective vision will not only not offend, but will be welcomed. I mean, Reuben Rivlin, the president of Israel in Warsaw at the opening of the museum, said those extraordinary words. He said, well, you can take the Jews out of Poland, but you can't take Poland out of the Jews. For an Israeli president, a very committed Zionist, to recognize that, I think it's pretty impressive.
I remember many years ago, 1985, I spent 6 months in Warsaw University as a visiting scholar. And there was a prominent Israeli journalist who asked me a favor. He said he misses his hometown, Minsk Mazowiecki, outside of Warsaw. And he gave me the memorial book. And he asked me to go there and just take pictures and tell him what the town looked like. And so I went to the town. I sat down in the cafe, which faced towards the big Catholic church. And people started to approach me, and I showed them the pictures in the memorial book, which showed the exact Catholic church. And then they started to look at the pictures of the people. And this was 30 years ago, so they still remembered the people. And they invited me to come back a few times. And I could talk a lot about this, but I'll just relate two incidents of this real memory. Somebody asked me to go to his house, and he said, we moved into that house when the Jews were taken to Treblinka at the end of August 1942. But my grandfather said it would be bad luck to move the bookcase. And so the original books were still in the bookcase, and he wanted me to tell him what the books were. And so there were some volumes of the Vilna Shas, the Vilna edition of the Talmud, the Rambam's of the Mishneh Torah. There were some Yiddish books, and he was so happy that I could explain to him finally after all these years what the books were. And there was another woman who said that the day the Jews were taken to Treblinka, a little Jewish child ran up to their gate, and she was yelling for her parents. And this woman was 11 years old and wanted to take her into the house and hide her, and her mother was very scared, as she had a right to be, because Poles were executed for hiding Jews, and the child was distraught. And this woman said, while my mother and I were arguing, a German saw the child and took him away. And I could never get that out of my mind. And when I went back to our old town in Poland, which is now Belarus, I was very surprised that elderly women came up to my sister, who never had been out of the United States until then, and said, you look just like your mother. So there were a lot of personal relationships. They remembered us, we remembered them. And it was something that really gets lost in unless you go back and have these face-to-face encounters. I'd like to raise another issue, which is that so many people are rediscovering their Jewish roots. And when someone does, when someone hears from a grandparent that they have Jewish relatives, or that they're descended from Jews, or that people were told that they were given away as babies to Polish families. When these people want to reconnect with the Jewish community, what are the different options that they have? What are the channels? What are the possibilities? Where could they turn to? What about Jews who were not halakhically Jewish? I'm wondering if you can all address that particular issue. I just remember that there was a Catholic priest who whose original Jewish mother lived in Charkovshchizna, and she was a good friend of my mother's. They were the same age. And my mother remembered that when this girlfriend was about to give birth, she left the ghetto, gave the boy away, and then went back in the ghetto, and she and her husband were later killed. And in the early 1990s, this person, who by this time was an associate professor at the Catholic University of Lublin, discovered that he was Jewish. And to make a long story short, he ended up in my uncle's house in Petah Tikva, where he heard all about his real parents and met his aunt and uncle from Cholon. And then he had an amazing odyssey as a Catholic priest who found out that he was a Jew. But so there are all kinds of stories, and I'm just wondering, what are the channels, what are the vectors, what are the options?
Well, I wanted to say this, that the previous questions sort of offer a footnote on the Jewish studies theme, that I've, over the past 20 years, actually met several people who went on to study Jewish studies in Poland, and only years later discovered that they actually had Jewish roots, and that the reason they really went to study Jewish studies was because they were driven by some sort of hunch, which is something that I'm writing about right now, so that it's close to home. But of course, that's only one of the ways, and it's a great way, by the way, because if you don't want to be religious, it's the best way to go. But of course, you can go to the Jew. Well, listen. In my personal story, when I couldn't hear from my immediate members of the family confirmations that I wanted to hear right then and there, and I didn't at the time that I wanted to hear them, I went and found the Jewish community in my hometown of Wrocław. I found the community. I knew I wasn't going to be religious, but I thought, you know what? I'm going to try and be religious, and I was for 8 years. Because if you're going to learn, it's the best way to, you know, jump in the deep waters. But that's, you know, just my personal story. Of course, there are many. This was 20 years ago. There are many more options right now. There are Jewish organizations in every larger city. If you're in a smaller city, you're in trouble. You should probably travel to Warsaw or to Krakow to try and find a way to reconnect with your Jewish roots. But in larger cities, the options are really growing and developing, and there are all kinds of ways you can try to reconnect. It's, you know, the question right now is, how many years have we still got for people to be able to confirm their hunches, if they have hunches, who's still alive to confirm those hunches for them, and so on and so forth. So it's, I think we're at a very fragile time in history for those people to come out of the closet. I only think we have only a few good years left in that generation.
I just add one thing, that reconnecting with the Jewish community or with the Jewish tradition does not necessarily go with discovery. There are a lot of people, you know, there are a lot of people that just simply did not care. And the fact that one does not care, that not necessarily mean that one doesn't know. So a lot of people, a lot of Jews today, they just simply, they didn't care and they do not care. They know, they knew that they're Jewish, they have Jewish ancestors. Some of them reconnect and some of them stay away. And of course, there are a lot of people who rediscover or simply discover the Jewish past as a mystery. If Katka had this family stories, I have my family story, my personal stories. A lot of journalists, you know, calling me and are just coming to Warsaw to visit Midrash and asking, when have you discovered your Jewish roots? Or I never discovered that. You know, I always do in a way. Oh, that's boring. So I'm the boring side, you know. And I'm for the story that people didn't care. People just, you know, there was a secular Jewish life always, even in the 70s, you know, Tes Kajet. And it was very impressive, but it still existed. There are people, you know,
Can you explain what that is for the...
It's Polish Towarzystwo Społeczno-Kulturalne Żydów, the cultural social association of Jews in Poland. So, and it always existed. Where people go, just went to Jewish theater and just went to, you know, to shoot the bar of the summer vacations like Catskills, you know, and did something Jewish. They have families in Israel and France and in the U.S., and so they knew. Was that a Jewish community? I'm not sure. I don't know. Maybe it wasn't, but it wasn't discovery. So I think that the discovery narration, it was very popular, I think there should be parallel narrative of continuity, because when you have the Jewish revival, so most of the Jewish revival deals with discovery, but some of the Jewish revival deals with a community, with a continuation, with, you know, with sense of, you know, people knew that, and people rejoined, just starting going to synagogue, going Jewish youth club or JCC, but they always knew they were Jewish.
The difference is that after 89, it was safe to be publicly Jewish once again. So what we had then was a small tidal wave. Several thousand people getting in touch with Jewish organizations because they decided it's safe, and we couldn't help them because we were a mess. We needed time to sort ourselves out. And by the time we had sorted ourselves out, we, the Jewish organizations, well, they had sorted themselves out too, and they didn't need us anymore. And this, in a way, is already a thing of the past. But the discovery thing is going to stay with us as people who are not secret Jews or Jews unsure if it's safe. There are Poles who have some Jewish origins, discover them, and very often are very interested because that makes them stand out in a society which is ethnically extremely homogeneous. But this doesn't entail any earth-shattering discoveries or identity changes or whatever, unless you have the bad luck of making the discovery in a small town. Because this entire process of the new acceptability of being Jewish, indeed of a certain desirability of being Jewish, hasn't really percolated downwards. It happens where you have urban cosmopolitan life. Not in the small towns, not in the villages. It isn't fun to be the only Jewish family in a small town in Poland. The way it wouldn't be the fun to be the only gay couple there. I mean, it's more or less the same thing. But this trope of discovery is is no longer dramatic. And this in itself, of course, is a huge improvement.
But I really think that in Poland, I mean, I agree with you, but I think that in Poland, I really see this difference between Poland and New York, for example. I mean, if you discover a single, even far removed Jewish root in a place like Poland, you are so much more likely to be interested in it and fascinated with it and sort of drawn to developing it further than you would be in a place like New York. In a sense, in Poland, you count to the minion more than you would here, because it's Poland, because it's because of the void that's around you when you discover it. I really think that that's something that is still present in Poland in every discovery of that sort. And that's what I've been hearing in narratives of other people that I've talked to, and that's how I feel about my own. And I also think that what we share, whether we're religious or not, and whether we always knew or not, is the discussion, is the sorting ourselves out. I don't think we're done. I think, and I meet Israelis in New York who tell me, oh, I'm Israeli, I don't talk about Jewish identity. As in, I have it figured out. I don't need to talk about my Jewish identity. And I also know New Yorkers who feel that way about their Jewish identity. Poles never feel that way about their Jewish identity. We discuss it. We will drink a lot of booze over our Jewish identities. We will, because we continue to think that there's stuff there to discuss and ask questions about. And I still think that we continue to ask more questions than we have answers. And as long as we do that, the process will continue to be a process.
Yeah, if you call it Judaism, so the discussion makes the identity, maybe it's a Judaism. It's more than religion. It's much broader sense, but it does.
Yeah. I'd like to turn to a subject that's very dear to my heart, which is the museum. Now, the museum recently opened. I've been working on it since 2006. There are great hopes for the museum. At the gala concert, I was very moved by the words of the Minister of Culture, especially talking about how she hoped that this would be a place, that this would be a catalyst for new understanding and new dialogue and a new sense of charity and forgiveness. And so since I've been so close to the project, maybe I don't have the proper distance. But of course, the museum has also spawned a great deal of questioning, a great deal of controversy. The hope is that it will impel Poles to reconnect with an aspect of their past that they've tended to forget, the multicultural, multi-ethnic nature of Poland. The hope is, and when we were designing our exhibits, I designed 1860 to 1939, the people I really had in mind, among others, were Polish high school seniors who would be coming to the museum on their high school trip and would be learning that the Jews were not some alien element, they were part of their country, and that Jews would come to Poland and see that Poland was the center of Jewish life for centuries. So I'm kind of wondering, how do you think the museum will influence the visibility of Jews in the Polish consciousness? And what about controversies that are arising connected with the museum, such as the location of a monument for righteous Gentiles that will be or will not be built right in front of the museum? Anyway, on that note, I can leave it up. Yeah. Kostek,
Look, it's always fun to debate something that almost nobody else in the audience has seen. So basically, I'd invite you all to come to Warsaw and see the museum. It's well worthwhile. And I rather expect that people will emerge very surprised, assuming they'll have the possibility of seeing the exhibition in its entirety. And when it's chock full of people, that's a very, very difficult thing to do.
I read your review in Gazeta Wyborcza. Yeah,
but basically, both Poles and Jews will be stunned just how interconnected their history has been. Because if there is one thing Poles and Jews would agree on is, well, good riddance, right? Lived together hundreds of years, didn't work, ended horribly, good riddance. But we can't. We've got a history that's largely shared, and we can't understand ourselves without the other guys, much as we might prefer this to not to be true. So that's one shock that people would emerge with. Another shock is, for the Poles, just how much antisemitism there was, how prevalent and permanent that element of the Jewish experience it was, and for the Jews, just how much there was besides the antisemitism. And then, of course, there will be, and I already can see it coming, the huge Milchama Yehudi over your part of the exhibition and your interpretation of Jewish modernity, essentially as Bundist. Walk through it once again.
You also have to read. You also have to read the catalog.
Nobody reads catalogs.
There's a Zionist part. There's an Aguda part. Bundist part.
Look,
the Bundists get the exact number of square centimeters that the Aguda and the Zionists get.
Yeah, because they don't need anymore. They're present everywhere. I mean, point is, Zionism is portrayed legitimately as one of different Jewish political orientations and not the dominant one. It wasn't. Religion is portrayed as an aspect of what Jews did, but there's about as much about religion as there is about Jewish economic life. Assimilationism is portrayed, yes, as well, some Jews did and they went forward in the world, but basically the story is of an indigenous Jewish people, we're not guests here, we're natives, that isn't going anywhere, is not abandoning its identity to assimilate, and remains Jewish even if it doesn't continue to be religious. Now, this is a narrative which will be very novel to many diaspora and Israeli Jews because it has disappeared from collective Jewish consciousness. And I can see big war coming. Of course, in Poland, the main issue was, won the museum be anti-Polish? There actually was a meeting, top-level political meeting, to find out whether this won't be the case. And when everybody breathed with relief that it's not going to be anti-Polish, a government minister suggested that, well, okay, it won't be anti-Polish, but from what I see, it's going to be boring. So you should spice it up, you see, like, show Fiddler on the Roof. But no, it doesn't downplay anti-Semitism and the pogroms, and it doesn't downplay the participation of Jewish communists in the building of communism after the war. It plays both issues in context, and the context is more important than the issues.
I just want to add that first of all, it's about Deutschkeit, it's about here-ness, it's that we are here. But, the Bund
Mind
didn't
you,
invent that.
There's nothing wrong in being Bundist.
Yeah. No, I'm not.
One of my best friends was, yeah. Okay? Marek Edelman.
But anyway, when we were designing the rebirth of an independent Poland, 1918-1919, of course, there were pogroms. The nascent Polish army, which was not very disciplined, and the Polish state, which was just getting organized, this was a chaotic period, and about 500 Jews lost their lives, which was a tiny number compared to what was happening in Ukraine, but this got things off to a bad start, let's put it this way. And so the exhibit had pogroms, and somebody said, Professor Kassow, pogrom, there were no pogroms in Poland. Pogrom is a Russian word. So therefore, pogroms couldn't have happened in Poland. So what happened in Lvov and in Vilno, and what happened in Częstochowa and Kolbuszowa? Professor Kassow, these were zajścia, these were excesses, but they're not pogroms. Pogroms happened only in Russia. The second thing is that when we had Polish professors look at our exhibit and to give us their opinion, we were afraid that they would say that we're slandering Poland and we're overemphasizing anti-Semitism. Imagine my surprise when these scholars said there's not enough on Polish anti-Semitism. You should say more about it. That was a real surprise. What about the monument?
Okay, just to, again, to put it in context, full disclosure, I'm on the board of the foundation that wants to build a monument to Polish righteous Gentiles, which we hope will be located by the museum. And the project has generated a substantial amount of criticism from the Jewish community. The main argument being that this monument will give an alibi to scoundrels.
What?
Give an alibi to scoundrels. Polish anti-Semites will say even the Jews were forced to recognize that Poles were not anti-Semitic, but they tripped over each other saving Jews and whatever. This fear is legitimate. I just don't think it's a valid enough reason not to build a monument to genuine heroes who deserve our memory and the public recognition. I mean, there are places in Poland where people are still afraid to admit that they saved Jews during the war because they don't want their neighbors to think badly of them. And then there is a counter initiative, a Polish Catholic nationalist initiative, which is building a monument to Polish righteous Gentiles on Plac Grzybowski, which was also in the ghetto during the war. And that initiative is based on a sense of outrage, sense of justice. The Jews recognized only 6,500 Polish righteous Gentiles, while, says Professor Żaryn, we already have 10,000 names and the target is 2 million. And I'm actually very happy. I mean, 2 million Poles wanting to save Jews, I want those names and addresses, we can still use them. But quite recently, at a public debate in the Jewish Historical Institute in Warsaw, Professor Żaryn explained, and I quote him, that there's a Jewish history of the war in Poland written by Jews which slanders Poland, and there's a Polish history of the war in Poland which protects the good name of Poland and reestablishes the true truth. And his initiative, he is the chairman of the committee building the other monument, is to support the Polish narrative. And I was forced to answer that last time science was divided by ethnicity into like Jewish physics and Aryan physics, it didn't end very well for the proponents of Aryan physics, and I don't think it will end well for the proponents of Polish history. And I'm only surprised that he dares use the righteous who fought against the proponents of Aryan physics to support his cause. There's much more that can be said about this. And until Warsaw City Council formally approves our project, we don't know whether it will stand or not. I sincerely hope it will.
Anyone else want to?
Well, my concerns about the monument are not concerns about the monument itself. They're concerns about the location of the monument and really the timing of the building of the monument also. And there's some of the concerns that are voiced by many letters that have come to you, I'm sure, that building a monument like this right after the museum is open may present itself as an act of, as an apologetic act on behalf of the Jews. We're sorry we built you this huge museum in the center of town. We will put up this monument to apologize a little bit for what we did. And of course, there will be some people who will see it this way. You can't deny it. I'm not sure that that's a good argument, but it's an argument that comes to mind. And of course, the other one is, why aren't monuments like these built in places like Yad Vabna? And of course, we know why, because they wouldn't stand there for too long, unobstructed and vandalized by the local population. So there's this issue of you're saying that there's still people are still afraid to come out as rescuers of Jews is precisely my concern about building a monument in the center of Warsaw, because it's, you know, you build it there, okay, so it's protected, there will be security, it won't be vandalized. While I think there's a sort of larger concern about why people are still afraid to come out as rescuers of Jews.
Your first fear is put to rest by Jewish critics of the monument, because if people see that some Jews think the monument should be built and other Jews think it should not be built, it might occur to them that Jews are not a monolith that is acting as one body, and might actually come to the conclusion that, well, some Jews built this museum, other Jews. I wasn't part of the museum. I'm very happy it's there, but it's not my responsibility, nor am I the museum's responsibility, and our monument is a completely separate initiative. And yes, in Jedwabne, it could not stand. I actually suggested building in Jedwabne a monument to Apolonia Wyrzykowska, who saved five Jews, and the then mayor of Jedwabne, who since had to leave Poland and lives in the US, Krzysztof Godlewski, told me that monument would not survive the night. Yes, so against the impossibility of building such a monument in Jedwabne, we're building it in Warsaw where everybody will see it, to create a public space in which the heroism of the few is honored, to shame the scoundrelish denial of history which still exists.
Well, the question arises, why did you choose the same location as the museum is?
For the same reason why the museum chose that location. That is where people will come and see it. You build a monument, you want people to see it.
But, I mean, there's one to Karski, there's one to...
Sendlerova.
Sendlerova, right? There. Yeah. Now there will be perhaps another one to the memory of the righteous. My apprehension to the location would be that since you have a museum that celebrates 1,000 years of life, in which the Holocaust is a small slice, and you know, to tell that story, it can also shift the narrative to something that tends to kind of gloss over or to kind of not glorify Polish, you know, heroism, but I think that's my kind of uneasiness with that specific location, is that people can come and see, we were so great, we opened Poland to them, King Kazimierz, you know, let the Jews in, they flourished here, they created, you know, Zionism, Hasidism, and then we saved them who survived this thanks to us. I think it's an easy way, if you put the monument there, to create a narrative that's, instead of kind of facing some of the dark spots and the blind spots of Polish history, makes it easier to kind of push them aside.
Well, this monument precisely addresses something which is a blind spot and a dark spot. It's built to people who still don't get in their country the recognition they deserve, which a visible segment of the population considers as people who erred, if not betrayed the cause by helping Jews. Among the conditions, the artistic conditions for the monument, we state very clearly that this monument must express just how alone the few heroes were. Mm-hmm. Now, as of the monument park, which has grown there, yes, if there had been only the Rappaport monument, I certainly would opt for a different location for any other monument, ours included. But if Willy Brandt can have a monument there, well, I think that Poles who risked their lives to save Jews at the times gave their lives to save Jews also can be remembered next to the German chancellor.
So maybe that was a mistake to put a Willy Brandt monument in the same square and to build a museum in the same square. It makes me, you know, it makes me a bit uneasy when I see that the square, you know, I remember it empty for so many years. And it happens, you know, that my family home stood, I think, at 100 meters from place where the monument stands now. And I think there's a monument which serves not only for the uprising, but it serves as a symbolic tombstone for all the Jewish population of Warsaw. And April 19th is not only the anniversary of uprising, but it's also, you know, your time. So I think that was my, you know, my first impression. When now I went to museum, I like it. I like the 20th century. That was my favorite. So I didn't like the medieval part because of the kings and the very nice history of, you know, of reclaiming Jews from all the dark places in Europe and accepting them. But I still have some doubts about the location of the museum. You know, I prefer this empty square because it gives you the sense of the void, and it shouts the sense of the void. Of course, now we have and because the building overshadows the monument in a way that it disappears in this space. And my concern was if the museum overshadows, you know, that what happened in the ghetto and what happened in this part of Warsaw. But we have the monument, we have the museum, so we have to deal with this.
Frankly, I'm very puzzled by this. So we've got the museum that overshadows the monument, the Rappaport monument, and now the future monument of the righteous Gentiles will overshadow the museum. I see there something which I recognize from elsewhere, the Polish fear that if Poland opens to Europe, well, Polish culture will be overshadowed by European culture, and if we speak too much about the Jewish participation in Polish culture, well, the Jews will overshadow the Poles. This kind of ridiculous feeling of insecurity that we're not good enough the way it is, and somebody will overshadow us. I think Polish culture is doing quite fine in Europe, and I don't see the Rappaport Monument overshadowed by the museum, and we'd have to build a mighty big monument to overshadow that building. So at least at this, I think your fears can be put to rest. Having said that, once again, the fears that the monument can be used as an alibi by scoundrels are legitimate. I'm pretty sure they will use it. But if this is still possible, it's not the fault of the righteous, okay? It's our fault. And they deserve to be commemorated.
No one says no, that the righteous do not deserve to be, you know, to be commemorated. But it was, the concern was that it was a part of a trade. So the government and the state built the museum, and we, the Jews, built the monument for the Poles, because the state was so generous to build us the museum. And, you know, it still is an argument.
The state is therefore manipulating the Jews, which brings me relief. Normally, as a Jew, I'm accused of manipulating the state. So if there is some kind of balance,
Can I offer something positive about the museum?
When
I was going to the opening of the museums, the day of the actual opening, I took a taxi ride in Warsaw. I got into the taxi. I said, because I didn't want to provoke, I said, take me to the museum on Anielewicza Street. He said, to the Museum of the History of Polish Jews. Yes, and I'm already waiting for it because I'm being nasty, and I'm actually thinking in a stereotypical way. I'm thinking I'm gonna have a nasty cab ride, and this guy says to me, "It's high time they built it. They've long deserved it." I'm still a little uneasy about this, but he says to me, "In '68, I used to have all these friends I played soccer with, and then they were expelled from Poland." And it's ridiculous, and it's all the fault of the Catholic Church. And seriously, it was like he was Podstawiony. It was like they just really somebody hired him to be my taxi ride to the opening of the museum.
Look, but as a journalist, I'd caution you against using taxi drivers as sources.
Right. And he said to me, I heard it's a little expensive, but I am looking forward to taking my entire family to see the exhibit very soon. And, you know, that's just one story that I have from you from Warsaw from, you know, a couple of weeks ago, which I think is great. And I think we have really yet to see how Poles, non-Jewish Poles, will embrace this museum, because we don't yet. We just know that they have flocked to the museum in thousands, and that's amazing. But we have yet to actually hear real, feedback.
Can I add one more thing, which is neither positive nor negative? I think the museum has to find its way, you know, to work with the Jewish studies, with the Jewish studies department in Poland and abroad. I can see that. I can see this is the beginning of the process. And since the museum will be, you know, this the the focal point of a Jewish life, or intellectually of a Jewish life in Poland. It needs to find its
I
way.
I thought Midrash
to,
is.
You know, to the departments of Yiddish studies, of Hebrew studies, and history, and other places, and not to overshadow it.
I'd just like to ask one last question. I'd like to ask two, but I'll only ask one. In 1990, Adam Michnik said that Poland is at a crossroads. One road leads towards a more secular European cosmopolitan identity, and the other embraces that ethnic Catholic legacy, as you mentioned, which, even though it holds very many bad memories for Jews, represents for Poles much of what is most valuable and most beautiful and most worthwhile about their own heritage. And at the time, Michnik defined it as a choice between one and the other. And I'm wondering if one would still say that 24 years later, whether there's a synthesis going on, whether Poland might go the way of Quebec and Ireland and simply become a much less Catholic country and become a very different country. And how do you see this playing out?
You know, when it happens, you have a fork at the end of the road, so part of a population when one go one direction and the other goes other direction. So it happens in Poland, you know. Poland is a very divided country, I think. Part of it went to Europe and the parts stay, you know, as it was. And the division is visible. I think it's even bigger and worse 10 years ago. That's my opinion.
Well, it didn't go the way of Quebec, right? Because in Quebec, it happened within 10 years. 1959 to 69, it was the Catholic Church was gone. And actually, I remember Michnik talking about this, and it was, one model was integrism. You know, would it go like Iran or Quebec? And actually, it has taken perhaps not the synthesis, but kind of a middle road. What I find interesting is that there's a lot of criticism and a lot of pushback against the church on the one hand, but participation in religious practices is still extremely high. People still baptize their children. Yes, there's a movement also of exodus from the church. People going through apostasies to formally leave the church, but people still go to church in Poland quite a bit. So I'm more optimistic than perhaps Piotr is, that it seems to me that it's still kind of going leftward, although the right is extremely vocal, so that the discourse of the left is constantly has to kind of react to the reactionary discourse of the right.
Well, I think the right became more vocal in the last years.
Yeah, but it's always very vocal and very effective in the images, in the discourse and the imagery it uses.
Okay, so maybe we can take a few questions from the audience.
Okay.
Wow.
Sam?
I'd like to ask this of Kostek. I sense a degree of histaigut, of refusing to be so excited about the museum. And I've sensed it not only from you, but also from others who have been key figures for 25 years and really for 35 years in the revival of Jewish life in Poland. And here's this museum with $110 million invested in it and a huge splash in the center of Warsaw. And forgive me, but we've been doing this for a good long time, for most of our lives. And now there's a new kid on the block. And not wanting to be so excited about it. Although many of you have, in fact, contributed to the conception of the museum. So that's one question. I have a second question of you. And that is, okay, it's not a question, it's a comment. I thought that the point in Gazeta Wyborcza that you made was not only that the exhibition gives too much space to the Bund, but that the conception of the exhibition is itself a Bundist conception. And I would think that I'm not implicated in the way that Sam Kassow is. I didn't contribute to the creation of the museum, but I did contribute to YIVO, and I have to say that the conception of the museum is not at all Bundist. There's no salute to socialism there in the conception of the museum, but it is thoroughly folkist. It is focused. And if that's the accusation that you meant, then I would say we should be proud of it. Because in today's Europe, in today's Western world, look at the alternative conceptions that could have guided this museum. A Zionist conception, an assimilationist conception, I don't know what an American conception would have been, but a focused conception that emphasizes the ethnicity of Jews, in European terms, the nationality of Jews, is in fact, I think, the most apt conception and the most useful conception, and one that Americans, American Jews and Israeli Jews, would recognize as their own. Not that there is a focused ideology or party here, but that this is in fact, look at the Pew study a year ago, this is in fact the way American Jews think about themselves in an ethnic way.
Okay, if an author is misinterpreted this photo of the author, not of the readers, I didn't mean this as an accusation. I meant it as a description, a statement of fact. And it would be ridiculous to broadcast the Bund backwards into history. But you're right. I mean, using the term focused would probably be more exactly expressed what I had in mind. But I already had to explain what Bundism is. But I had to explain what focism is. The editors would simply dump my piece. As to the first thing, what you seem to be saying is, they dared build this museum without you? Of course they did. I mean, the fact that 25 years ago I knew, or I think I knew, most of the Jews in Poland, and now I know I'm just a small minority, and the small minority knows me, this is success. If I'm skeptical of the museum, it's the way that I'm skeptical of big things. Big things can be wonderful big time. It can make big mistakes. But I root for it. I'm a reluctant convert to the concept of the museum, mainly because, as I was explaining to somebody before we started, so lock me up in a geriatric ward, but for me, museums are buildings that have wooden boxes with glass tops and things inside, okay? And this is not what Warsaw Museum is. So I'm a very late convert to the concept. I feared it might be Disneylandish and Fiddler on the Roofish. It isn't. And some elements of it are absolutely stunning and impressive, intelligent, and thorough. And there's absolutely nothing to be ashamed of. But look, big things go big. And it always slightly intimidates me.
Irene? Yeah. I wanted to address the issue of the monument. And one of the things, I always try to think of things in practical terms. I feel that the Polish righteous absolutely deserve to be memorialized, commemorated, and remembered. However, I feel that it would be far more appropriate that in every spot where a Polish citizen saved a Jew, there would be a plaque on the house, and it could be high enough so that vandals couldn't take it down. I think that that would be a far more effective way of memorializing the Polish righteous. I also feel that the square on which the museum and the monument stand is our sacred ground, and it is inappropriate, I think, to have most of the other, the Willy Brandt, the Karski, the Irena Sendler. I really feel that the Polish state has the entire rest of the country that's ours.
If I may, as to your first suggestion, you heard it first here, I have the promise of the president that, in fact, he will endorse this kind of initiative to have righteous commemorated wherever they were active. In many places, local authorities aren't terribly eager to. They don't think it's a good idea. And as to our hallowed ground, yes, if there would be no other monument, as I said, but the Rappaport Monument, I'd certainly prefer it to remain that way. But the righteous are part of our story. They're not aliens that land in the middle of what was the ghetto. They are part of our story and our memory. And just as much as the heroes of the Warsaw Uprising are. So on this, I respectfully disagree. They are ours.
I would agree with you, except that the Ziegelbaum Memorial is not on the square. And if you're going to start arranging who and what ends up on that square, we're going to have no lawn, no trees, no anything, just a forest of monuments. Every week, suggestions come in. Why isn't there a monument to Janusz Korczak on the square? Why isn't there a monument to... And it goes on and on and on. And I think the calling a halt is probably the better way to do it. I absolutely agree that the Polish righteous deserve, must be remembered.
Viva?
There's actually a fascinating phenomena that's the Oscars, the Academy Awards, the filmmakers in Poland that are also bringing this topic very much. I'm making a film on Agnieszka Holland. So we have Europa, Roper, we have Angry Harvest, In Darkness. She wants very much to make a film on Karski. So, and she feels very Jewish, but in her own way in her filmmaking. And I hope that not only will Ida will be nominated and will win. And that is so much the story of a nun discovering she's Jewish. And I think tonight, in terms of the discussion, we should really remember our Polish filmmakers who are bringing this, and they're choosing it as the entry into, that's very political in its own right. But anyhow, it was fascinating. I can't wait to see the museum, Sam.
Hi, I'm also from Warsaw, Poland, by the way. And I have a quick question. I'm not sure how simple. So you've mentioned identity. So I have a little personal question to you. What's your identity? Is it Jewish, Polish, or what, Bundist? So.
What?
During the census.
I'm just the moderator.
That's the identity.
During the census, the previous census, there was a question on ethnicity, narodowość, and the census inspectors were instructed when asking this question to suggest Polish, and only if somebody said no, that they have the right to opt for something else, like Jewish, Ukrainian, Eskimo, whatever. Not surprisingly, 1,229 people gave their ethnic identity as Jewish. It would be 1,230, but I was out of the country on census day. In the last census, you were allowed to adopt a hyphenated identity like Polish-Jewish or Ukrainian-German or whatever else, and the number of people who declared themselves hyphenated or unhyphenated Jews grew to 8,000, which I think is an answer to your question.
Does anyone else want to answer his question?
I'm a sociologist.
I'm a panelist.
I'm a rootless cosmopolitan.
No, actually, there's two of you in the room.
Okay, yes.
Thank you. Poland today, it seems almost a split personality. One of the most anti-Semitic countries in Europe with an exceptional high level of anti-Semitism, 50%. On the other hand, one of the societies of the most open embracing of Judaism and probably the most pro-Israel in all of Europe. I have trouble, is it a divide between the urban and the more small, what's causing this dichotomy?
It's mainly the result of the fetishization of sociological data. Professor...
I'm a qualitative sociologist, by the way.
Yeah, Professor Suek, a Polish sociologist, did a survey in which he asked variations of the same question to three identical samples representative of Polish society. One group he asked, does any group in Poland have undue influence on Polish life? Spontaneously, 5%, more or less, said the Jews. In the second version, there was a cafeteria to choose from. Does any of those group have undue influence over Polish life? And the cafeteria included Jews. And 10% said that Jews have undue influence on Polish life. The third group, the question was, do Jews have undue influence on Polish life? And 25% said yes! Now, does that mean that the real answer is 25%? Or does it mean the real answer is 5%? Or does it mean take it easy with sociological data?
Okay.
Hi. First of all, I want to say that my father, who arrived in the Bronx at 11 years old in 1927, always said, we are Jews from Poland, we are not Polish. But what I really wanted to ask about is, with the resurgence of anti-Semitism that we hear about over here, I would like to get a real feeling of what's really going on over there with, you know, next door, in the Ukraine, in the government, you have neo-Nazis, and next door in Germany, you have a resurgence of neo-Nazism. And so is anybody watching the horizon while all these celebrations are happening in Poland?
Well, to the best of my knowledge, the extreme right in the Ukrainian parliamentary elections and in the Ukrainian presidential elections got around 2.5% of the vote. There was a Jewish candidate in the presidential elections who ran on the ticket that he's Jewish, and he got almost 3% of the vote. There is a growth of extreme right-wing extremism in the West, including in Germany. In the town of Wuppertal, which is the birth town of Rudolf Hess, the city hall was unable to stop a neo-Nazi march. So it set up a fund in which citizens and businesses pledged to pay 10 euro into the fund, which was destined for the support of Jewish and immigrant institutions, for each 100 meters the neo-Nazis will cover when they pass. So the more they marched, the more money they made for a cause they probably did not endorse. So Germany is reacting. We have a growth of anti-Semitism in Poland over the last couple of years. It's marked, it's clearly visible in sociological surveys. This is the reversal of a consistent trend over the last 25 years when anti-Semitism was in decline. I do not know, frankly, what to attribute it to. My hypothesis is it might come from exposure to anti-Semitism in the West. The Poles did house cleaning in the kind of provincial belief that with this kind of dirty laundry, anti-Semitism, racism, whatever, it won't be accepted in European salons. And then we entered the salons and we realized that, like provincials will, we simply checked the previous Parisian fashions, not the latest Parisian fashions. And now we are adapting them. But I really do not know. But there is a growth of anti-Semitism. In surveys, not, it doesn't express itself in everyday life.
Right. What expresses itself in everyday life is what my now husband and I did last summer, this past summer. We organized a wedding. We got married in Poland in front of the synagogue in Wrocław on a Sunday afternoon. The wedding ceremony, the whole party was 12 hours long. It was the chief rabbi of Poland, the chief rabbi of Wrocław marrying us. It was an Orthodox wedding publicized on the radio, television, in the press. There were posters around the city. We invited anybody who wanted to come and see what a Jewish wedding ceremony looked like. About 1,000 people showed up, and not a single person wanted to disturb us. Everybody brought flowers and presents, and they continue to send us letters with thank you notes. So that's the anti-Semitism that we got when we organized a big wedding in Poland. One example.
I just want to say that I love Paris, but I would much rather, I'd be much safer today as a Jew in Poland than as a Jew in Paris, in part because for me, the anti-Semitism today that really matters, that you really have to worry about, is the anti-Semitism that's nicely packaged as anti-Zionism. And in this sense, Poland is much more hospitable for Jews than Norway or France or Ireland or the United Kingdom.
I can actually confirm this empirically. I run around Poland with a kippah and I don't run into problems. I occasionally, very infrequently, hear nasty comments, and I've learned not to respond because a passerby will respond in my name. I can rely on a Warsaw street the way I can't rely on the street in Paris. I was physically harassed thrice within a week in Paris with people looking the other way and pretending they don't see. And when I tell my friends about it, they ask me, oh, these were the people who did the harassment. They were the young people from the suburbs, right? Which is the polite expression, the PC expression for young Arabs, to which I answered, well, I'm not racist enough to tell the difference between a young person from the suburbs and a young person from Marseille, but I'm pretty sure that the people who pretended not to see were good Frenchmen.
We're going to just take one more question from the audience. Jonathan.
Thank you. So maybe less of a question than a comment, something that came up about overshadowing the Rappaport monument by the museum. I would just toss it out there. Is that a bad thing? Should a museum of 1,000 years of Jewish history overshadow a Holocaust monument, which is, you know, talks about the suffering of 6 years of by the Germans? I would make a case that it not about maybe not the word overshadow, but I would make a case that the museum really helps us see the totality of the situation. You know, for us, I think it's important to, from a Jewish perspective in Poland, I see Kostek disagrees with me, which already means that I must be on the right track. If from a Polish point of view, there are three streams of the narrative from a Jewish point of view in Poland. One is the loss, which I think we in the United States and around the Jewish world do a very, very good job of connecting to. I'm sure there aren't many Jews in the world that don't know about the Holocaust. But the other two streams have gotten a short shrift, really. One is the 1,000-year Jewish history, which the museum will do a fantastic job. And I don't share any of Kostek's reservations. I went through the exhibition 3 times, and I think it's phenomenal. And the other is the revival of Jewish life, this miraculous revival against all odds, which is still very much going on. The institution which I head has people walking in almost every day finding out about their Jewish roots, which is not the remarkable thing. The remarkable thing is that the atmosphere in Poland has become so incredibly conducive to them acting upon that, and that they're still finding, walking in the door and saying, teach me how to be Jewish. I just found a box in my grandparents' attic with strange photos and people with beards, and I want to connect to that. And it stands in stark contrast to what's going on in the rest of the world or in the rest of Europe, and I would say here in the United States. If you would walk into a Polish university and say, let's boycott Israel, they would look at you like you just landed from Mars, and the issues that we're dealing with here in the United States. So Poland, I think, is, I don't want to say, I was told the other day not to say it's the only bright spot in the Jewish world, but certainly one of the best stories today and most important stories that we can all rally around as a people is this revival, which I can tell you from the front lines in terms of what we're doing at the JCC in Krakow, is still very much underway. So if the museum, you know, again, we're at a very interesting point in history as the last generation of Holocaust survivors in the next 15 or 20 years, you know, really those are the last ones that will be with us. And the role of the Holocaust in Jewish identity is a very, very important issue. And I think that our message in Poland, certainly what we're trying to do, is to say that we're Jewish despite Auschwitz, not because of Auschwitz. And I think that the very interesting geographic situation of the museum across from the monument, to me, speaks as I see it. I think that who we are as a people is history, is our history, is 1,000 years of history, not only what happened to us, and we need to write our own history, and I think that's what we've done with the museum.
Well, I'm delighted you take your guidance from me. You've got it halfway right. But I think this entire discussion is ridiculous. I wish something could overshadow the Shoah. Nothing can. It happened, it's still here with us. And the museum cannot, even if it wanted to, even if it tried to, it cannot overshadow the Shoah. Nor does the Rappaport Monument overshadow the museum. Both tell different stories.
We're talking about revival. There's one revival that we haven't mentioned that it just occurred to me that is really happening in this room, and that's a revival of the North American Jewish interest in Jewish Poland today. And I think that the fact that we're all here tonight is an expression of that, and I think that's a revival that we should really find another time to talk about.
Well, thank you very much for coming, and thanks to our panelists.